go strip down.
Yeah. So you've been doing this for a little while.
I have been.
Not your first rodeo.
No, I've been running around with a camera since I was a kid, really, since I was a teenager.
Was there something that drew you into it, or you just kind of...
I came of age in the late 60s, you know, so Hard Day's Night, Graduate, Bonnie and Clyde, Battle of Algiers, then the New York school started, you know, Taxi Driver, Godfather. So, you know, movies were, at that point, as a young person, kind of the cutting edge, and they were about what was happening in the world. For me, Dr. Strangelove probably was, you know, I was maybe 13 or 14, but that was like, wow, a way to look at the world. It wasn't just a movie.
Mm-hmm.
And then as a teenager, I happened to be lucky enough, one of the first gigs I ever got was with the Maisels. I was I worked on Gimme Shelter.
Wow.
As a teenager. So that was, I said to Al Maisels before he passed away, they did a little retrospective of some of my work. And we were talking, I said, Al, you know, I just recently realized that, you know, that moment at Altamont, that movie, how profoundly it affected almost everything I've done. How, you know, kind of that was the death of the 60s, literally.
Mm-hmm.
In December 69, it was about sex, drugs, rock and roll, politics, race, violence, you know, the black kid with a gun, the Hell's Angels with the knife. It was all there.
Mm-hmm.
So I think all those things, you know, kind of that was the place to be. And I guess I've kind of shuttled, you know, through different areas, although always coming back to the documentary form of you know, I've done features, I've done TV series, all incredibly stimulating and exciting. But there is something about, there is no take two, this is the real thing, these are the real characters, the real people that somehow, you know, I get off on.
Mm. And the subject matter, I mean, from a pretty early age, race was part of your work.
Race, politics, culture, society, how it's changing, how our, you know, I mean, again, the 60s was such a turbulent time. Such a fertile time, and the battle over that legacy of mm-hmm. what really happened then and what its significance is, you know, certainly starting in the 80s as my career kind of more formally started, and for the next 30 some years, 40 years, it's really been a battle over what happened and mm-hmm. its significance, you know, a counter reaction, revolution, reactionary, conservative movement against everything that happened, and we're still living with it right now, what you just had on TV. So I'm still part of that battle.
So is it getting better or worse, or is it any different?
Well, look, change is part of life. I think certain things are better and certain things are worse. I mean, and that really speaks to the film that I just did, the Class Divide. You know, when people say, is gentrification, the changes in a neighborhood, you know, is it better or worse? It's good, bad, and ugly. I mean, you know, I've lived on 26th Street in Chelsea, Manhattan for 40 years. When I moved in, it was the edge of the garment district, the flower district. In fact, when my wife's mother first came and visited, that she was living with me, she started crying. She just couldn't believe her daughter ended up in a factory on 26th Street. Mm. Now there's a Hilton down the street, you know, and Soledad O'Brien lives upstairs, and you know, it's just totally transformed. Certainly, there are certain things that are better: public safety, public education, the public school that's on the corner of 9th Avenue and 26th, which is in the film that a young kid, Joel, goes to. I wanted my kids to go to public school. I went to public school. I thought it was valuable. But to my wife's credit, she said, no way they're going to PS 33. It was an F school in the latter 80s. Now it's an A school. You got kids being busted because it's got one of these special advanced programs.
Right.
the neighborhood's much safer. Now, of course, all New York has, you know, changed from the crack era. But, you know, at one point I had the horrible experience of walking my kids to school and a parking lot attendant who we knew right on our corner had just been shot dead. So, you know, the fact that the schools are better, it's safer, those are good things. At the same time, you know, the grit when you're young and when I moved into the loft, you know, I moved in with a bunch of buddies. It was a freak hangout, like a global party crash pad. We didn't care. There was no heat on the weekends. There's a factory above. You know, we were oblivious, and that there were certain more dangers that didn't matter to us. And the mix, even going into the 80s, you know, the nightlife, pre-AIDS, pre-crack, there was a sense that you go out and you would meet anyone, you know, that from rich to poor, black, white, Puerto Rican, Asian, it was just all about the mix, the magic. You start to lose that, it's like, that's the soul of New York. I'm a New Yorker, I was born in New York. You know, that's why it's the world city. The city of the world is that every different kind of human being is somewhere in the five boroughs of New York City. So the idea of it turning into a gated community, a gilded cage, that's abhorrent. And it's actually, the irony is it stifles and suffocates and sanitizes everything that attracted people in the first place and even made it valuable in the first place. So when you see the local shops disappear, you know, and then people who are friends, neighbors who can no longer afford, and part of kind of what got me to make this film, Class Divide, is, you know, for 17 years I've been walking down 26th Street, you know, to the Hudson River, to 601 West 26th, which is where my studio is. And thinking, you know, it's an interesting walk because, first of all, you first go by these TV studios where, you know, they have these talk shows now. But it was the original players, Charlie Chaplin, Douglas Fairbank, Mary Pickford, it was their original studio. So, you know, I always feel, my God, you know, kind of one of the birthplaces of movie business right on my walk. Then the next block between 8th and 9th is Penn South, which is the working class and middle class apartment complexes that were built by the garment industry, by the unions, the ILGW, the Amalgamated, and really are some of the last middle class, you know, great deals in New York. Then you come to the projects, which are in our film, the Elliott Chelsea public housing projects between 9th and 10th. And then you come to what is now the High Line. Now, who would have thought? And I'm just reading, when I was sitting in your living room here, an article about Hudson Yards, you know, and a new artwork that they just unveiled that's going to go up. I mean, that's right out my window. Who would have thought, and that's kind of part of our movie, you know, one of the founders of Friends of the High Line, David Joshua, is in the film. Who would have thought this derelict, abandoned railroad yard, you know, would turn into, you know, one of New York's great tourist attractions and a catalyst to an insane real estate gold rush? In fact, it was the real estate industry that wanted to get rid of it. I had mixed feelings because my son got arrested on it for graffiti when he was like 12 or 13. Oh. So that was like, uh-oh. And then walking to work, it was, you know, all the pigeons lived in it.
Right.
You know, so you had to dodge on the way to work and on the way home. But I must admit, I never thought. I remember the debates, and the real estate industry said this is what's holding back the development of the Far West Side. You got to get rid of this thing.
Yeah.
And these two guys who had no experience in urban planning, in anything, they just kind of came up with this idea. It's really an incredible story, and created Friends of the High Line. Unintended consequences. You don't know. You know, who would have thought that would have inspired all these famous architects to build, you know, their most outrageous and wild designs that are selling for $50, $60, $70 million.
It's exactly what happened in Miami Beach with the Art Deco thing.
There you go.
They just wanted to knock down all those buildings, and that became the center of turning South Beach into South Beach.
And that, I mean, I have to say, originally, you know, this was very personal. It was very local. I thought, okay, a New York story, to HBO's credit, to Sheila Nevin's credit, you know, they gave me the freedom. But I think they saw that, no, in a way, it's really a microcosm, and what you're seeing, the hyper-gentrification and income inequality and class inequality, education inequality, that's not just on the far west side. That's mm-hmm. in cities all over this country, and communities are trying to figure out, you know, how do you grow? How do you develop? How do you stay plugged into this global economy, because a lot of this money is coming from overseas, and yet keep your soul, not lose what makes a community, what makes a city vibrant and creative and exciting to live in. That is a tremendous challenge.
And so did this come to you as you were on your stump on a walk one day? And
it wasn't one day. It was, over years thinking about, I often thought about Ulysses, Joyce's, great classic, of how he, in just a walk through Dublin, mm-hmm. Created this journey in consciousness. And yeah, I often thought, just how could I tell the story of what I'm seeing? I would go away for a few weeks and come back, and a building came down or a new one was going up. So, how do you tell it? And because we had done this film, Schmata, Rags to Riches to Rags, and then following that, we did this film, Hard Times Lost on Long Island, and HBO really hadn't ventured much into, I guess, what you would call the political economy, its impact on real people's lives. Mm-hmm. I was badgering Sheila, for years about that, and she would often joke, oh, Mark, go pitch that to Bill Moyers, your old friend, or go to Frontline, or, we don't do that here.
Right.
And so I think she was, and we certainly were, surprised by the response they got. It was actually at Toronto that we premiered Schmata. Mm-hmm. How many people are connected to that business, to that just world, from high fashion right to the sewers, the cutters, grandparents, uncles, aunts, who all got a start? Really the American working class and middle class, that was one of the doorways in. So they
were, if you ever lived in New York, you know that's all talked about, but it's long ago history now. 7th Avenue is not what it was. So
I live right,
fascinating to see that movie and see what happened.
Exactly. And yeah. and the building I'm in now, that's the irony, the Starrett Lehigh building, where I have my studio. Ralph Lauren is right upstairs, his showroom. Martha Stewart has, a whole floor. Hugo Boss, Tommy Hilfiger's down the hallway from me. But it's all the marketing. It's not the right. manufacturing. So I think we were all surprised by the feedback and how, just interested people were. So we did this second one, really, which was the follow-up, the Great Recession, and really like the sons and daughters of those who had gotten started in the garment industry, mm-hmm. now moving out to the suburbs. We chose Levittown as the symbol of kind of post-war suburban America. Mm-hmm. But when the Great Recession hit, the crash of 2008, we followed these people who had been successful and their lives were devastated. And very difficult to recover, long-term unemployment and not in any coping mechanism with all of a sudden, what's my life? I feel mm-hmm. worthless. So the success of those two films, Sheila was like, well, let's do a third. Let's finish this trilogy. And we actually came to the West Coast, Daphne Pinkerson, the producer, myself. We went up to San Francisco, where obviously the techies, you've got the takeover of parts mm-hmm. of the Bay Area. We went down to Florida, where you were just talking about. And it was really, it sounds like an apocryphal story, but it was true. We were sitting on the High Line. And on 26th Street, there's a frame they left, mm-hmm. Like a poster billboard frame, but there's no poster in it. It's like a tourist attraction. There's a spur there, you can sit. And we were sitting there on a beautiful day like this and watching all these people taking pictures, stand in the frame, let me take your picture. And in Chinese and French and every language you can imagine. And then thinking, these pictures are going all over the world. And do they have any idea what's in that frame? Because there's Avenues, this new world school, this mm-hmm. new elite private school, right on the right of the corner there. And there's the Elliott Chelsea projects, public housing projects, right behind them. And all of a sudden we were like, yeah, I guess it depends on the frame you look at, mm-hmm. what you see, but this juxtaposition, is this what we're looking for? Mm. And we shot just a little around there, since our studio is down the street. Daphne also lives in London Terrace, you know, in Chelsea on 23rd Street. Showed Sheila some of these kids, you know, because we're meeting people. And she was immediately, to her credit, was like, you don't need any urbanologists, sociologists, politicians, political scientists, real estate, you know, you do it through the kids on the two sides of the street. That was a great intuition, and it helped us kind of limit the scope. And the trick then was getting permission to shoot in Avenues, the World School, because, as you said, I've been at this for a while, and I would honestly have to say that getting into an elite New York private school is right up there with getting into the CIA, death row. I mean, I put it right up there. To Chris Whittle's credit, we were able to convince him that we weren't coming with an agenda. He likes the limelight. He's a figure that has very much been in the public spotlight and controversy over the years. And he gave us permission. But there was a self-selection process, because obviously some families, you know, were in no way up for it. So we made it clear we're not going to push our cameras in anybody's faces, only kids that want to be part of it, only kids whose parents are comfortable with them being part of it. But getting access was, you know, that was a big step.
Yeah.
And on the other side, I mean, I knew people in the projects. I knew people, Hudson Guild. My kids had gone to Hudson Guild. Mm-hmm. Their first teacher, when they were 4 years old, preschool, was Whoopi Goldberg's mom. And Whoopi grew up in those projects. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that was really the genesis and the beginning of it. But, you know, it all comes from your question. Is it better or worse? It's a trade-off. When you're 21 and you want to stay out all night, the Wild West Side was great.
Right.
Who wanted, you know, the gentrification and the safety and the upscale boutiques and stores and everything like that? You know, you get older, you know, you have a business, you know, it changes. But certainly part of the reason I think we were able to convince Chris Whittle was to say, honestly, look, I came here and I was part of, I guess, what you would call urban pioneers, you know, first in a neighborhood, a new neighborhood. Somewhere in the late 80s to the early 90s, you know, this so-called creative class, you know, which is displaces people as part of the gentrification. I became part of, you know, the creative class. I said, now, here I am, I'm looking at being displaced myself in my studio, which is spectacular. And yet, you know, because of Hudson Yards and everything that's happening, the High Line, you know, the rent is insane. And so I got a few years left, but you know, I'm now at that place where I don't know that I can afford to stay.
You're the riffraff.
That's exactly. I am the riffraff, exactly. Which kind of comes full circle. That's kind of where I started. So I was able to say, though, that I'm not, you know, good or bad. I'm not coming with an agenda, because I've seen it from all perspectives. And it depends where you are. It depends on that frame. Where you are in life, you know, what your point of view is how you see it. And there is both good. There is definitely bad. And there is ugly. And there's beauty. I'll be interested to see this new design that was just unveiled. That's what I was reading about, this new public artwork that's going to go in Hudson Yards. So I think, you know, the goal here, and again, I got to give HBO credit, because you couldn't make this film commissioned by anywhere else. In other words, I could have made it personally or financed it personally, but because it's not celebrity driven or it's not major crime, you know, some horror or world event, all important and make sense, it wouldn't have gotten the support. And we had that freedom. And also,
has that changed over these years?
Yes, tremendously. I mean, again, good and bad. One, documentaries now, as somebody, you know, as I said, I was 19 on Gimme Shelter, which was a feature documentary, got a lot of attention, Rolling Stones. But at that point, you didn't think of documentaries as necessarily a real career, even though the Maisels were the beginning.
It was just them.
Right, and Penny Baker, a few others. But And so now, nonfiction, documentaries, docuseries, you know, it's the rage, which is fantastic. And even, you know, you were at Toronto, but even you go to film festivals and you hear more people talking about the documentaries now than you do necessarily about the features.
They're almost always better.
And they're more, again, when you ask me what was it, they're more about what are we talking about?
Right.
What's happening in the world? You know, and now we live in a world where there's so much information overload. You know, we have so much input, making sense of it is critical, and journalism has had its struggles, and television is fractured, so people are looking for synthesizers and people to take all this and put it together in stories that somehow make sense about what's happening in the world. That's how I originally, you know, when I said Dr. Strangelove, for me, why that was a revelation was, God, we were doing those air raid drills and duck and cover and all that madness and, you know, the Cuban Missile Crisis. And even though I was just a kid, beginning to be aware of this world. And then I see this movie and it's like, oh, my God, yeah. You got to laugh at this.
Yeah.
You can't be cowering under your desk and crying that, you know, what's going to happen and aren't we all going to disintegrate? You got to just ride it. Ride that bomb. Mm. So that's how I, you know, and Battle of Algiers, for me, that was, wow, that was a mind blower. You know, that someone could make a movie that you really felt you were witnessing, I guess, terrorists, revolutionaries, you know, fights against colonialism. And certainly, Gimme Shelter and these first documentaries were like, wow, that's our generation. Look what's happened.
Yeah.
So that's the good part. The flip side, though, is what you're referring to is that now that it's more in the spotlight, it's the pressure's on. Where's your celebrity? Like, I saw a series, which is good, that'll be on Epic, American Divided.
Mm-hmm.
Norman Lear, Common, Rosario Dawson.
Mm-hmm.
Powerful, compelling stories, but using, let's get celebrities so people will watch, you know, as correspondents. So I think there is much more pressure to kind of have what you would call hooks, you know, to market. You know, the marketing is much more now where people didn't think about marketing documentaries. You know, okay, you make it, great. You know, good luck. Hope a few people see it. Now it's like, how do we, you know, look at The Jinx.
Right.
Look at Making a Murderer. You know, how are we going to market?
Murdered somebody, you'd be in better shape.
Right. Exactly. How are we going to do this? So that's why I think, you know, part of again, I give credit. And finally, you know, just about kind of having the freedom to kind of experiment a little more, to kind of deploy some lyricism and kind of more poetic sensibilities and associations. That area that this film is set in is now the art capital of the world. 24th Street, I mean, Soho, you know, in New York City was for many years. Now it's Chelsea. 24th Street is considered the capital of the art world. And 26th Street, where we were, you know, has got all the galleries.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought it made sense that the film could be a little more experimental, to be in tune with the very neighborhood. And the music in the film, I don't know if you're familiar with Marc Rebo, but, you know, incredibly accomplished musician, guitar player, composer, and how that happened was interesting. I was at a the protest you see in front of one of the brownstones that's, you know, being converted and people are being forced out, and I ran into an old buddy of mine who is a real political activist. And, you know, we talked, I told them a little what we're doing, and somehow it came up, you know, the soundtrack, what music you're going to use, you know, what are you thinking? And I said, that's a great question, Bob. What is the sound of Chelsea? You know, what's the sound of Chelsea? And so he says, well, do you know Marc Rebo? I said, yeah, I know Rebo. He's fantastic. Love him, because I've done two films with John Zorn, and Rebo is kind of part of that posse.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, why'd you bring him up? And he goes, well, back in the 80s, he led a squatter movement on 17th Street. They took over a building. You know, he was at the forefront of a kind of the first, one of the first battles in Chelsea to fight against gentrification and being displaced. And he said, you know, you should get in touch with him. So he gave him the number. And Mark and I really hit it off. But I think that music, again, is a key element of this film. You know, in other words, that he just intuitively gave it something special, something magical.
So you, the issue of education in and of itself was not really your focus here?
No. I mean, no.
Or your interest, even, really. Primarily.
No, it is an interest because obviously, you know, so much of these things goes back to education, opportunity. Mm-hmm. I think the first in the film, there's, you know, we use in the billboard, you know, a few kind of what you would call fact cards. Mm-hmm. And the most stunning one, which is one of the first, is that this idea of upward mobility, the American dream, which we grew up with, you know, that, hey, if you get a good education, you work hard, you know, you can make a better life for yourself and for your family. It's no longer true. That America is way down the list of advanced industrial nations in terms of if you're born poor or working class, your ability to move up mm-hmm. to middle class, upper middle class, wealthy. We think everybody has that opportunity, but that is shocking. You have more opportunity in Canada, you have more opportunity in most of the advanced European countries mm-hmm. than you do in the United States. So that's the bottom line, in other words, that on one side of these streets, no matter how talented or how much potential those kids have, mm-hmm. what are the chances that they're going to get to fulfill that versus the kids on the other side of the street that have tremendous privilege? The irony is that what comes through and was a surprise to me is that the common ground between these kids on totally different sides of the street is a shared anxiety about where they fit in to the future. The wealthy kids now aren't just competing with Fieldston and Riverdale. They know they're competing against the Chinese kids, the Indian kids, the Pakistani kids, the Russian kids. It's a global competition now. Mm. And they're not confident that they're going to be able to do as well as their parents did. Mm. The lower income kids are aware of this incredible change happening around, and the very idea of public housing seems archaic. Who's building new public housing? Right. So the very and the
jails.
There you go. That's sadly. Right. Sadly, where's their mom going to live? Their grandma, their aunts and uncles. So they're, you know, our commitment as a society to some kind of social safety net and some way of giving opportunity that people have less means. They're not convinced that our society still is committed to that. Mm-hmm. And they have good reason. So they both share this anxiety in a neighborhood where they are literally seeing the world change right in front of their eyes. Mm-hmm. And the good thing, the positive thing, in as the film progresses, is that on both sides of the street, whatever stereotypes, prejudices they may have about who's over there and who's over there, mm-hmm. there's a desire to get to know each other. And that sounds so simple and so basic, but it's the kids that led the way in this neighborhood. In other words, now, thank God, the institutions are following and being more aggressive and trying to become part of the community work. But if you look at what you just had on the news, the Trump world, the Clinton world, you know, the Sanders world, nobody's talking to each other. Mm. Everybody's so fixed in there, you know, so that there's no discussion over, okay, well, how do we make this system, which is not a force of nature, meaning this global consumer capitalist system that mm-hmm. now most of the world is plugged into, how do we make it work better? Because if we just end up with a kind of new Middle Ages where you have this, you know, aristocracy, this 0.01%, and everybody else is struggling like a serf. Mm-hmm. That's a world nobody wants to live in, including the kids of the very wealthy. They don't want to be helicoptered to school with bodyguards and the chauffeurs that pick them up, afraid they'll be kidnapped. Afraid, you know, mm-hmm. who wants to live in that world? So that is a challenge in many ways, I think, that these kids somehow intuit, is every generation has its fight. We were talking, I grew up, you know, and I saw these movies, the civil rights movement, the anti-war movement, the women's rights, sexual revolution, gay rights, environmental movement. These kids You got climate change on one side, and you got this question of economic justice, inequality. You know, how do you make a system just work better so that it delivers its wealth to more people? And I don't believe that means in any way stifling entrepreneurship, creativity. Like you, I'm a small business person. I believe in entrepreneurship. I believe in independence. I'm an enemy of huge bureaucracies, whether they're government bureaucracies or corporate bureaucracies. Yeah. You know, dealing with a network's not that much different than dealing with the motor vehicle department or the Pentagon.
nicer couches.
So that's kind of what emerged. But it was, the idea was more observational, you know, trying to capture that moment when this one community, which is a microcosm of these changes, through the fresh perspective of young people, not weighted down by all the arguments of the past, and that there's still a sweet spot there, meaning that the mix is still alive. The projects are still there. This school is still new. So there's still an openness. Hudson Yards is going up. Who knows what this will all look like in 10, 20 years. But you still have enough of that mix that you feel the vitality. And I wanted to capture that.
You feel restraint? I mean, because I feel like you showed actually a great deal of restraint on some level by not engaging more things, and you know,
I think that's true. In other words, look, if you're familiar with any of my other films, you know, there probably is more political punch and some more investigative, you know, definitely a fervor and pushing freeway cracking the system, which I'm honored was just nominated for a national Emmy for investigative journalism. We'll see how we survive next Wednesday against three front lines. But no, you're right. There is restraint because I felt two things. One, the kids, I just was so enamored, you know, and Rosa, you know, just was a knockout, and the other young people that I wanted to remove my voice in a way because theirs was fresh. And the other was that I didn't want to overlay the polemic. In fact, I even wanted to confuse it a little. That's, you see Rosa's brother, you know, in the park telling his buddies, you know, hey, you know, I think I'm a Republican now. And they're all looking at him like, what? Are you out of your mind? And no, well, I'm going to make a million by the time, you know, and it, he has that line, you know, it's okay if you're born poor, but it's not okay if you died poor. So, yeah, you know, kind of mix it up. But I think you're right. There was a restraint, but I'm glad for that.
So, and including the, you know, the epilogue, which the fact that finally some kid got into the school seems kind of miraculous. Seems like that would be almost a movie unto itself.
Well,
and the exit of
Whittle.
Whittle, yeah.
Right, right. Yeah, look, the story could go on. And in many ways, I think back to 7 Up, you know, that documentary, you know, series, which is a classic. I thought, you know, when I look at the film now, like last night, I thought, yeah, it would be interesting to come back in 10 years, you know, instead of just doing and see where the people are, see what Rose is like, see what, you know, Yasmin, but also to see, to look at a neighborhood itself as like a thing, a person, you know, and see what happens, you know, to this neighborhood. Hudson Yards will be built by then, and then come back, you know, in 30 years like they do in the 7 Up series.
We've been involved in this in LA with education. My wife has got very involved with starting with our preschool, which is progressive, and the issue of trying to get kids of color on the west side of Los Angeles, and how even if you offer scholarships, just physically getting there every day is a hardship for a lot of families, and it's a very difficult thing. Whereas, what's one of the things that's fascinating about your movie in that particular situation is that they're there. They're right across the street.
Exactly.
And yet it took them however many years to get the first kid into the school. It's kind of fascinating.
It's a good point. And obviously, you know, the fact Rosa didn't get in at the premiere of the film last fall. I mean, you should have seen some of the community's reaction and some of the you know, outside the theater afterwards, accosting the administrators from avenues and people screaming, "Are you out of your mind? And what's wrong with you? And you couldn't have found the better person." You know, it was very passionate. But I think, you know, to Avenue's credit, I went to the Hudson Guild fundraiser a few months ago, and I was kind of surprised. I see two tables of Avenue's parents, you know, for the first time. So I think that message from the students to the film to just all over is gotten there, and I think they're being more aggressive. But it's true, you know, how to do that. In a way, you know, because one of the things I never thought of, you know, is like, you don't want to get a kid in a school like Avenue's and then have them feel, oh, I'm less than everybody, right, and everybody is, you know, so much smarter or has so much more. You don't,
you're a token, is there?
Right, yeah. Or you're, you know, so how, you know, that, of course, is why public education was always appealing. I went to a public school. You know, it's just there was such a mix, and you learn to deal with the mix.
Right.
You know, that's an education in itself. You learn to deal with all kinds of people.
Yeah.
It's a great challenge. I think the whole education, you know, because I did Chicagoland. We were on the South Side, and Liz Dozier was the lead character, the principal of that school. I mean, my God, you go to a high school where half the kids don't know where they're going to go home at night. And whether they're going to get shot, because, you know, they got to go through certain gang neighborhoods. I mean, the challenge
is... And the University of Chicago right in the middle of it.
Right. The challenge is of trying to figure out how to save public education is huge. And I am interested in it. I wouldn't say, you know, this film kind of developed in its own way. But that is a tremendous interest of mine. My sisters are very involved in that field. And I think that is, when you go, you know, when you talk about solutions, if you can't find ways to, you know, kids with so much talent, so much potential, to give them the opportunities, you know, something's fundamentally wrong. And now, you know, and I did Brick City, now whether it's charter schools, you know, the big debate over charter schools, Catholic schools, I did a film, Prayer for a Perfect Season. You see how the Catholic schools are unfortunately closing because of all the money they've had to spend on these scandals. And they were a place where poor kids could go and get a good education, also a sports, you know, always. It's troubling, and I felt guilty when I sent my kids to a private school. You know, when my wife prevailed in that argument, and they didn't go to PS 33. At first, I felt guilty. Now I'm glad. I think she was right, and my daughter, thank goodness, tested into Stuyvesant, so that was quite an experience. It's probably one of the most unique public high schools in the world, but it's a huge challenge. Huge challenge, and you know, we just kind of scratched the surface. You see, really, it's more you see Avenue's kind of some of the techniques and technology, but you don't really go into, like, in a public school, and there the bureaucracy, I mean, just getting in and shooting a little in PS 33, what I had to go through, I was like, my God, I got at Avenue's and everything I had to do, and now you're telling me I can't even shoot in the public school? Give me a break. So that is an issue I hope I can find in the future, the right story.
Well, it's funny. I think that one of my theories about documentary in the last while is that I think in this era where there's so much more being made, that the idea of any one film covering the waterfront, as it were, is now impossible, and that it's a combination of almost like, you know, your film, The Ivory Tower, which is about the colleges,
right,
and Cooper Union, you know, starting to charge and all of that, and... it's almost like you need six films to really cover a subject, and you should. I mean, there's something better about not trying to be everything to everyone, you know.
I think you're so right about that, and that goes to this idea now that people will watch 6 hours, you know, or watch a number of films that are all thematically related, you know.
Yeah.
I think that's so true, and it also is liberating in a way, because it means you don't have to take the voice of God, the correspondent. You know, we're here, now we're there. You know, is it good? Is it bad?
That's
right. You can take a point of view.
Yeah.
You can choose a frame, you know, to look at your story and say, hey, you know, somebody else, you know, did that perspective.
When a good filmmaker, the universality kind of bleeds through no matter what, ultimately.
Hopefully.
There's a great film in Toronto by Steve James, a new one, that's actually kind of retro for him because it's more of a straight doc, but it's called Abacus, about the bank in Chinatown.
Oh, wow.
And it's like, you know, you kind of think it's this very small story about this one family kind of under stress from the government and all of that stuff, but all the pieces of the, you know, the Trump story and all the where we are politically in the world all kind of emerge
organically
and, and as with your film, where, you know, it's about New York, a very specific block, a very specific situation, but completely identifiable in Los Angeles and Chicago and everywhere else, I would think.
Well, as you said, look, and I'm certainly a fan of Steve's, that's the trick, you know, is if you can do it in a way that you're not attempting to be global, but by the characters and by the way it's put together, it has a universal, you know, humanity to it that touches people. That's the trick. That's the fun.
Mm. So is it as fun as it was when you started out and had the concert all those years ago?
You know, then I saw myself as a, I guess you would call it an insurgent, a rebel. You know, I remember I used to have my friends over on Saturday night at the Maisel's Cutting Room because I was an apprentice, you know. I did what a computer chip now does in a millionth of a second, reconstituting film. Mm-hmm. And we'd look at Tina Turner and Stevie Wonder, you know, all the stuff that didn't make it into Gimme Shelter. That was exciting, you know, and when the Hells Angels came over and threatened the Maisels and it's hard to match, you know, being a 19-year-old and feeling you're getting in the middle of all that.
Yeah.
I think now it's, I guess, the excitement now is having more opportunities, you know, kind of seeing that documentaries, which, you know, I didn't care then if anybody respected it or if it was reviewed or if you did, you know, an interview like this, I couldn't give a shit. You know, it was a whole different attitude. Now, I think the excitement is seeing stuff that you kind of imagined, fantasized about, thought about. It's actually real in the world now. It's happening, and kids, and meeting kids like the avenues in 10th grade. You can take a course, documentary filmmaking.
Man,
in fact, I had the class come over when we were doing Chicagoland. I said, okay, you know, here we're in a high school on the South Side, you guys should see this and we need feedback. Mm-hmm. So you're going to be like our feedback group. You're going to be our focus group. They came in the editing room, they met my editors, you know, and they gave us their mm-hmm. feedback, and they saw a little how we were putting that series together. It is exciting. Alex, you know, Gibney, who's in my space, Susan Lacey's in my space, you know, to kind of be in the middle. I saw Rachel and Heidi at the Norman Lear event. You just mentioned Steve James, you know, to feel part of a community that somehow has gone from maybe the fringe or, you know, all mm-hmm. doing our own thing, you know, Barbara Koppel, you know, John Alpert, you know, that you're part of a community that somehow took something and now it's out there and everybody's into it. I think that's exciting, you know. So, you know, maybe I am a veteran, but, you know, I still feel connected to the youthful spirit. And I think that's what part of what made this film, Class Divide, special for me is that getting to mix it up with teenagers, I confess to Daphne Pinkerson, my producing partner, you know, I hate to admit it, but I don't know that I ever grew up, you know. I'm still a bit of a 16-year-old maniac.
That is the goal, isn't it, I guess?
I guess so.
Well, I think Alex is trying to catch up with you, even though he's a little younger.
Well, Alex and I have been playing tennis. I, you know, knew Alex when he lived out here.
Mm-hmm.
And we started playing tennis on La Cienega, on those courts mm-hmm. over there, you know, 30-some years ago. I actually hired him to come into the space when we first moved in and had this company offline and had done Slam. You know, always knew the guy was an extraordinary talent, and he has just blown up. And so that's exciting to see. And, you know, and Susan, I didn't really know, but you know, she's you know, become part of our community. So I think that, you know, when you say feeling part of a community, you know, that you're some, that's exciting, you know, and that you respect people. Like when we went, we brought Class down, Divide down to Havana in at the Havana Film Festival in December. Alex was there with his Sinatra film. John Alpert was there with his film on the gay rights movement in Cuba, which was fascinating because Raul Castro's daughter was in it and the star. Rory Kennedy was there with her film on her mom. So, you know, to feel part of that kind of community and see where it's grown and that it's kind of been embraced, and even in a society, you know, in Cuba, which is changing. And I know I was like, well, what are they going to make of this film? You know, does it really fit in? Right. And what I found amazing was one or two people came up to me and said, you know, our whole country is like that corner. And I was like, what? And they were like, well, we're about to be plugged in to this global economy. It's going to happen. Mm-hmm. You know, we're at that point. And yet we don't want to lose our soul. We want to be part of that. We're tremendously frustrated, right. You know, yet we don't want to just be a shopping mall like Puerto Rico or the Dominican Republic or a vacation spot. You know, we have a culture. We have a soul, again. And how do we get this? How do we get wealth and become part of that and yet not lose?
Yeah.
And I was like, well, send Rosa down.
Well, how do we get running potable water on the Malecon? I mean,
there you go.
And roofs that don't
right drip and not, you know, sell it just to Trump or related, yeah, or, you know, whatever, so that none of us, yeah, can live there, you know. So I think that is exciting.
Yeah. No, it's I'm glad you're still excited.
Yeah, no, it's part of my personality, damaged at a young age, I think, on the subways of, I always thought of, you know, when I see like infants on the subway, and I think of myself back then, it's got to have some kind of imprinting on you, bouncing around and then seeing all these faces and, you know, kind of, and not being apprehensive, somehow getting over that and getting kind of turned on by it.
Well, you keep doing the work and it keeps feeding that thing in your brain that,
that's it,
makes you happy.
That's it.
What else could you ask for, really?
No. Very lucky.
Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it.
Appreciate it. Thank you for having me.
Pleasure.